In this video, we'll examine fluid static problems that involve compressible fluids rather than our simplified case of incompressible fluids. Specifically, how is the static pressure going to be related to a height for our compressible fluid? So let's start with some basics. Imagine lying on the ground. Now imagine a dog pile slowly forming on top of you. As more and more people get on top of the pile, the larger the force you experience. Thankfully, we could assume we are incompressible elements and thus will not deform under the added pressure. Now, for most problems involving liquids, assuming the fluid is incompressible may be a good assumption, especially when working with low pressures or relatively low changes in elevation. Now, a good check for this assumption is to look up the relationship between pressure and density in a thermodynamic table for the fluid of interest. Now let's imagine the case where we are not an incompressible element. If we start adding more people on top of the dog pile, the force we experience is going to start increasing. The pressure we experience acting downwards on us due to the weight of the elements above us will start to increase. Now this increased force acting down will start to compress us at the bottom. So you can imagine the more and more people that we add to this pile, the more dense the state of us at the bottom is going to become, since all this pressure is pushing down on us and causing us to compact greatly. Now when we think of compressible fluids, gases should come to mind. When we compress a gas, that the density of that gas is going to change. So what does this difference mean in terms of relating the fluid height to pressure? Let's start with our equation of motion. Our equation of motion has been derived in other videos. Basically, we have a pressure gradient and the weight of our object acting in a vertical direction, so in this case, our z direction. And this force balance is going to be equal to how the object accelerates. So for a fluid at rest, we have no acceleration, we could relate our pressure gradient to our weight. For our fluid at rest, the only pressure applies in the vertical direction, or like I said, the z direction here. So we get an ordinary differential equation that relates the pressure in the z direction to our specific weight of the fluid. Recall that our specific weight is just the density of the fluid times our gravitational constant. So let's take a look at the case where our fluid is incompressible. If it's incompressible, our density is constant, not a function of pressure. So that means our specific weight is constant. So we have a pretty easily solvable differential equation. So let's draw our system. If we have some height, z1, and we're going down, and we want to examine the pressure as a function of depth, we'll say P2, and then at this other elevation, Z1, we have a pressure P1. Then we would evaluate our integral from P2 to P1, set this equal to negative gamma evaluated from Z2 to Z1 dz. This gives us the relationship P2 is equal to P1 minus gamma Z2 minus Z1. Now, it's more common that you might see this as h, or the height from z2 to z1. So that being the case, p1 is also equal to p2 plus gamma h. So there's our linear relationship between pressure and the height of a fluid with specific weight gamma. So let's take a look at the case where it is not incompressible. So we have some compressible fluid. So that means our density is a function of pressure, and that means our specific weight is not constant. So we need some relationship between density and pressure. Now for an ideal gas, we could use the ideal gas law, so let's just start there. So our ideal gas law says that the density is going to be equal to our pressure over the gas constant and the absolute temperature. So now we can plug this relationship for density into our equation for our pressure gradient, because the specific weight is the density times gravity. So that means this will go up here. So we get the following integral, which we can separate variables and solve and integrate from our same boundary conditions that we used before. So you should get an integral that looks like the following. Now, the thing to note here is that we are looking at an isothermal case where our temperature is not changing as a function of the height of our fluid. So we can solve the integral. Now we could also write this into a more common form shown here. This relates our pressure at some point 2 to our pressure at point 1, our change in height, our gravitational constant, our gas constant. Again, we're doing this for an ideal gas, and some temperature we're using for the fluid that we are examining. So you can see this is a nonlinear equation relating pressure at points 1 and 2, and is quite different from the one we just derived for our incompressible case. So we are assuming that the gravitational constant G and the gas constant R are not changing and constant with elevation, which is a safe assumption. We did solve this for the isothermal case. If, for instance, we are looking at a large elevation change in which the temperature is not constant, like maybe our atmosphere, then we would need a relationship between temperature and elevation as well. So let's look at a case where the temperature is not constant for the elevation that we're examining. We could use a linear relationship as an example to demonstrate this. So let's say for the first 10,000 kilometers in elevation from Earth's surface, the temperature can be related to the height through the following. So we'll say that the temperature is equal to our sea level temperature minus the elevation times this value beta. This value beta is known as the lapse rate, which is really just the rate of change in temperature with elevation. So now we have a relationship between temperature and our change in elevation. So we can put this temperature back into our original equation here and resolve our integral. So now for temperature, instead of pulling it out of the integral, we're going to keep it inside. I'll say that this is temperature sea level or T naught. So let's solve this integral using our same conditions as before. So our first step, we simplified it to the following, evaluating the integral from Z2 to Z1. And you should get the following. Now this could be simplified just a little bit easier to get something that you may see in a textbook and get the following relationship. Now if we use that Z1 is sea level and the elevation is 0, then this simplifies even further to relating P2 to a pressure and our change in elevation. So now we've represented our change in elevation as just Z. Remember, beta is our lapse rate, T naught is our sea level temperature, G is our gravitational constant, R is our gas constant. Now we have a relationship for a compressible fluid in a non-isothermal case. In another screencast, we'll use all three of these to show you how different our results can be for evaluating the pressure at an elevation above sea level.